Let's take it back to 2004 during the U17 European Championships. The French squad was full of young and promising talents that were just miles ahead of everyone else, and would go on to eventually win the title. Here's a picture of some of their best players at the time. Now, most of you probably recognize this guy right here. Yup, it's a young Karim Benzema, considered one of the country's best prodigies. But you see those two next to him? They were considered to be even better than Benzema at that age. No other than Hatem Ben Arfa and Samir Nasri. 10 years after this picture was taken, they were at their absolute primes. But fast forward to 2021, and these two have seemingly never been heard from again. It's like they completely fell off the spotlight of the footballing world. Are they washed up and simply not good at football anymore, or did other things outside of football distract them? Well, today, we're gonna find out. But before we start, if you don't want to end up losing your skills or falling behind the rest of the world, today's sponsor, Skillshare, is the perfect place to go to make sure that never happens. Skillshare is an online learning community with thousands of inspiring classes for creators. Whether it be business, graphic design, music, photography, or much, much more, no matter what your passions or interests are, Skillshare is always launching new premium classes that are always 100% ad-free. So you can focus, learn, and follow your creative path. Whatever interests or passions you have or have always been interested in learning, why not join Skillshare and start learning today? I'm sure some of you know the saying that goes, hard work beats talent when talent fails to work hard. And it's absolutely true, not just in the case for football, but for everything else in life as well. Learning new things or getting better at something you've already been good at is an amazing feeling, and Skillshare makes it possible. The first 1,000 people to use this link will get a 1-month free trial of Skillshare. So make sure you check out the link in the description before it's too late. Once again, thanks to Skillshare for sponsoring today's video. Let's start with Samir Nasri, the kid who scored the game-winning goal against Spain during the U17 Euro Finals. Immediately following that summer, a ton of English teams like Arsenal, Chelsea, Liverpool, and Newcastle were desperate to sign him, but his youth club, Marseille, would offer him a spot on the men's team. In just his second year, at 18 years old, Nasri was given a lot more chances and began slowly taking the role of a starter at such a young age. Nasri would be very crafty at the attacking midfield position, and having teammates like Frank Ribéry made it easier for him and helped him develop more quickly. Nasri was even an important piece in Marseille's 2005-2006 run to the French Cup final. With Marseille, he'd get more experience and slowly start to develop, improving his performances every year and ultimately ending with 12 goals and 30 assists in 166 appearances. Although the club wasn't really successful, Nasri had shown that his talent was there and that the sky was the limit for his potential to playmake, distribute, and score with his all-around game when it came to his role at the attacking midfield. In 2008, when it was time to renew his contract, Nasri was about to continue staying with Marseille until no other than the great Arsene Wenger decided to take Nasri under his wing as he saw how much potential the 21-year-old had. He was an instant favorite with Arsenal fans, having a decent first season with 6 goals and 15 assists in 44 appearances, which wasn't bad at all for the 21-year-old who had just started to adjust from Ligue 1 to the Premier League. Believe it or not, Nasri was nicknamed a young Zidane in his young age for his skills and flair, although probably a lot more wild and inexperienced compared to Zidane at the same age. Still, Nasri showed he could turn games around with his dominant play at a moment's notice. He'd have quite a tough time in his second year as he suffered a broken leg and missed a majority of the season, but over the years with Arsenal, he would develop even further as a player. In the 2010-2011 season, Nasri would have his best season at Arsenal, scoring 15 goals and having 5 assists while making a name for himself in the footballing world as a crafty attacking mid who had great touch, skill, and could use both feet equally well. Believe it or not, although his stats weren't that impressive, he was named French Player of the Year just for his style of play alone, with even his coach Arsene Wenger giving him constant praise and calling him a magician on the pitch. But nothing would compare to Nasri's all-time prime in Manchester City. On his very first season for Man City in the 2011-2012 season, Nasri quickly became one of the most important pieces for the club. He was one of his team's main orchestrators for the attack. The offense would almost always move through him when he was on the pitch, and he even became the guy to go take their penalties and free kicks at times. Man City would iconically win the Premier League title this year, and Nasri was a huge part of their success. Though his stats might never really show it, the intangibles, including his passing accuracy, passes completed, overall dribbling, and chances created are what really made him a special talent and really shot his popularity up during the time. His absolute best year with Man City was in the 2013-2014 season, as he'd go on to have 11 goals and 12 assists in 46 appearances, helping Manchester City win another Premier League title, with this time Nasri playing an even bigger role than their last championship run in 2012. If anyone watching this has ever played FIFA 12 to 15 as much as I did, you would know just how popular Samir Nasri was. Pretty much everyone used him to build their squads because he was just way too popular, and plus his player was usually overpowered in those games, but you know, it really only made him even more popular for people who never paid attention to him before or were never aware of his skill. But for now, we're gonna go ahead and leave Nasri's story right here while we go back to see Hatem Ben Arfa's path following that U17 Euros final in 2004. Hatem Ben Arfa was one of the most athletic kids on that French squad. His pace and stamina was perfect for playing as a winger. He played for Lyon basically his entire youth professional career, who saw him as a prodigy since the age of 15. Now, if you look at his stats during the first 4 years of his career, you might not think that they're anything amazing, and I would completely agree with you. I mean, you could see a slight increase in production with more playing time and more appearances, but other than that, it's nothing to be too amazed at. But the interesting thing is that Ben Arfa significantly helped his squad when he was on the pitch. His presence would lessen the load from the inner midfielders and actually spread the defense around when they would give him the ball to attack or run down the line. Ben Arfa didn't need to score many goals or provide many assists, but he was almost always involved in a majority of Lyon's counterattacks or chances created. This can be seen as he won the league title for 4 consecutive years with Lyon from 2004 to 2008, which were basically the first 4 years of his career. Imagine that type of success in football by the age of 21. But in 2008, when he signed for his new club, Marseille, Ben Arfa got a lot more of what he wanted. Playing time. He would play phenomenally for his first 2 years with the club and perform a lot like his breakout year during his last season with Lyon. His impact to the team was also seen during his time in Marseille, as he would help them win the 2009-2010 Ligue 1 title and the 2009-2010 League Cup. However, this was when things would start to go bad for Ben Arfa. Ever since his time with Lyon, many have noticed his behavioral changes both on and off the pitch. He would get more and more yellow cards, as well as have temper towards referees and opponents. His work ethic is also known to have significantly decreased over the years. While transferring to Newcastle United, he would suffer a broken tibia and basically missed an entire year. It didn't really help him at all that the rest of his time at Newcastle was pretty disappointing as well, showing how he never really improved that much since his days in France. However, that doesn't mean he was bad. He played very consistently, but just never managed to break out. Despite that, he was still gaining popularity, becoming a fan favorite for scoring some magical and impressive goals. Even fans of other clubs in the Premier League and fans of foreign leagues would pay attention to his highlights on YouTube or use his character in FIFA games when he was at the height of his popularity. It's just that the superstar that everyone anticipated Ben Arfa to be never really came into fruition since leaving France. And slowly, as he departed Newcastle for Hull City, he really fell out of the spotlight. Now, back to Samir Nasri. After his incredible 2013-2014 Premier League season title, his attitude towards the game got a lot more relaxed and casual, and it didn't help that the following season would see him sustain minor injuries, as well as making it harder for him to get back in full form, even if he tried really hard. If you look at his last two seasons with Man City, you'll see how he began to slowly perform poorer and poorer each season. When he finally left City in 2016 on loan to Sevilla, Nasri seemingly fell off the face of the earth. He wasn't in any form of spotlight whatsoever. After barely lasting a full season, he would move on to the Super League where, I'll be honest, even less spotlight was given to him. He would try to make a comeback to the Premier League and play for West Ham, which made people slowly start to pay attention again. Although shortly after, he'd get that attention he wanted, but just not for the same reason, as he was banned from football for nearly 2 years after being caught doping and using physical enhancing drugs. He was once considered to be the next Zidane, but Nasri unfortunately just never lived up to the expectation. Ben Arfa, on the other hand, has actually had a change in his personal attitude and work ethic, as he made a few comebacks like in the 2015-2016 season, where he had the best statistical season of his career with 18 goals and 7 assists in 37 appearances. He'd also go on and sign with PSG for a couple of years and win the 2016-2017 French Cup and 2016-2017 Ligue 1 Cup. At the making of this video, both Nasri and Ben Arfa are currently free agents and aren't signed to any teams, while the third kid in that nearly two-decade-old photo just went on to have one of the best seasons of his career with Real Madrid. But we can look at Karim Benzema's journey in another video for another time. If you guys could take one lesson from this, it's always a good idea to stay humble, work hard, and never give up or get complacent with what you do, or you might never reach your full potential. So make sure you do check out that Skillshare link in the description below if you want to learn new things and reach your potential as well. But that's it for today, guys. Leave a like if you enjoyed or remember these two players when they were at their primes. Every single like counts, and it's honestly the best way to support the channel for the YouTube algorithm, besides subscribing if you haven't already for the best football documentaries on YouTube. But seriously, thank you guys for all the continued support, and I'll see you in the next one.